Let's work three problems related to voltage regulators. We're going to start with a shunt regulator, for example one. We're given an input voltage that's nominally at 13.5 volts, but it's not perfect. The job of the voltage regulator is to give us a more perfect output voltage. In this case, the zener diode is going to have a 9-volt breakdown, and we're told that it has a slope resistance of 5 ohms. We're given resistors for R sub S and our load. Our job here is to calculate the range of our load voltage and the line regulation. Since we know the range of our input voltage, and I'm tasked with finding the corresponding range of our output voltage, what I really need to do here is just find an equation that relates the load voltage to the line voltage. In order to do that, I'm going to redraw the circuit, but I'm going to replace the zener diode by an equivalent circuit model. Let's replace this series resistor by its value of 100 ohms. Our load resistor is 1 kiloohm, so let's draw that in. We're told that the zener diode has a breakdown voltage of 9 volts. I'm going to use the circuit symbol for a battery to represent it. It's not a battery in the traditional sense, though, because current doesn't come out of the battery. It goes into it. It just represents a 9-volt drop. It doesn't actually supply any power in this case. Finally, we have our slope resistance of 5 ohms. This completes our circuit model. When I look at this circuit diagram, I only see two variables, V sub L and V sub I, so it shouldn't be too difficult to write an equation that relates one to the other. Let's label our currents. Let's call the input current I sub S, let's call the output current I sub L, and let's call the current passing through the zener diode I sub Z. I know that the currents have to sum to zero at this node, so let's write that relationship down. To find the first current, I sub S, I can just apply Ohm's law across the first resistor. I have VI to the left, and I have VL to the right. I is just V over R. For the zener diode, I can just apply Ohm's law across the 5-ohm resistor. Finally, for the load current, I can again just use Ohm's law. Current is voltage divided by resistance. Let's multiply every term in this equation by 1,000 in order to get rid of the fractions. Let's now write this out term by term. Let's concentrate all of the V sub L terms over to the right and put everything else on the left. Let's swap left and right sides and divide everything by 211. I have my answer, or at least I'm almost my answer. I have an equation that relates the load voltage to the line voltage. Let's make a little chart that relates the line voltage to the load voltage, and we'll look at the two endpoints. The minimum line voltage is 12 volts, and the maximum line voltage is 15 volts. If we plug in 12 and 15 for V sub I in my equation, I can find the corresponding load voltages. I can see that indeed the voltage regulator works. I had a 3-volt variation in my line, but I wound up with a 0.142-volt variation at my load. I already have my range of V sub L. I'm only left with finding the value of the line regulation. We have our delta VL in the numerator, and we have our delta VI in the denominator. It's typically expressed as a percent, and when we plug in the values, we find that the line regulation here is 4.7%. In example two, we're going to look at the same circuit, but now we're going to make a plot of the output voltage versus the output current. Let's again convert our zener diode into an equivalent circuit model. We'll assume that it has a breakdown voltage of V sub Z and a series resistance of R sub Z. Just to be clear, in this diagram, I'm going to go ahead and draw in an ideal diode down here in the path of our zener diode to indicate that current can only flow in the downwards direction along this path. Let's prepare our plot. On the vertical axis, we're going to be plotting load voltage. On the horizontal axis, let's plot load current. Before I get started, I want to make the plot for an ideal voltage regulator. An ideal voltage regulator would just have a horizontal line. The voltage at the output would not change even as the current drawn through the regulator would change. Of course, that's not what we're going to get here, but we're going to get something not too far away from it. Let's first make a dotted line indicating the zener diode breakdown voltage. We'll assume that the input voltage is higher than our breakdown voltage of the zener diode. If the input voltage were hypothetically smaller than V sub Z, the zener diode wouldn't do anything at all, and my plot would just be a straight line. It would look something like this. Therefore, we're going to assume that our input voltage is higher than the zener diode's breakdown voltage, such that the diode works as designed. Let's start at the no load condition. I'm labeling this point no load because no current's going to flow through the load. That would be the situation, for example, when the load resistor is very, very high. At the no-load condition, all of the current that enters the regulator has to pass through the zener diode. The reason why the voltage at the no-load condition is a little bit higher than the zener diode's breakdown voltage is because of the resistance R sub Z. There will be a little bit of voltage drop across that resistor. That accounts for this vertical distance here. As we start to lower down our R sub L from infinity, more current will start to branch off. Not all of it will go through the zener diode. As the current through the zener diode drops, the voltage drop across the R sub Z will get smaller and smaller. That's why this line slopes downwards. Once the output voltage equals the voltage drop across the zener diode, the zener diode's current will become zero. Once the zener diode's current becomes zero, the circuit behaves as if the zener diode is not there at all, and we're back to the situation of a voltage divider. Down here, we're at the short circuit condition. The load resistor just equals zero. The current is maximized, but the voltage is zero. The graph has two regions of interest. Up here, the zener diode is on. Down here, the zener diode is off. The slope of the curve up here is related to the series resistance of the zener diode. The slope in this region is just related to the voltage divider set up by R sub S and R sub L. In the third example, we're going to design a negative feedback voltage regulator. We're going to be supplying 12 volts, and we're told that the maximum load current is a half an amp. The supply voltage ranges from 15 volts to 24 volts. First, let's calculate our minimum load resistor. We have 12 volts at our load, and we're told that the maximum load current is going to be a half an amp. Maximum load current corresponds to minimum load resistance, so we can conclude that this regulator ought to be able to handle a resistor all the way down to 24 ohms. What would the power rating of that resistor be? It would just be V squared over R, where V is the output voltage. We'd better make sure that our load resistor can dissipate 6 watts or more. We're told in the problem that the breakdown current of the diode is 1 milliamp. Therefore, at least 1 milliamp has to flow down through the zener diode. We can assume that very little current flows into the op-amp. This means that RS has to be sized so that at least 1 milliamp can flow through it in order to supply the necessary current for the zener diode. Now, how should we size our resistor? Should I plug in the maximum input voltage here or the minimum input voltage? Let's first try the maximum input voltage and see if it works. That would imply that RS needs to be 19 kiloohms. What would be the current then flowing through that resistor when V sub I is 15 volts? In that case, the current passing through the resistor would only be a half a milliamp, but the diode needs 1 milliamp to break down. Therefore, this is the wrong way to calculate it. We should have used the minimum value of the input voltage in order to find R sub S. If we look back at our equation for R sub S and substitute in 15 volts for V sub I, then we find that R sub S should be 10 kiloohms. That means when the input voltage is 15 volts, exactly 1 milliamp is flowing through that resistor and on through the zener diode. What current flows when the input voltage is then maximum? Well, since we've chosen a value of R sub S of 10 kiloohms, we can just use Ohm's law to find the current. We find that 1.9 milliamps would flow through the zener diode. No problem. The idea here is to design an RS which can supply the necessary current to get the zener diode to break down. What does the power rating of the zener diode need to be? Well, to find the power rating, we need to look at the maximum current flowing through the zener diode. In this case, it was 1.9 milliamps. The diode has 5 volts across it, and with 1.9 milliamps of current flowing, it would have to dissipate 9.5 milliwatts. How about the power rating of R sub S? It's going to have maximally 1.9 milliamps through it, and we know the value is 10 kiloohms. The resistor needs to dissipate at maximum 36.1 milliwatts. We now need to design our feedback network. Since the zener diode has a breakdown voltage of 5 volts, we need to ensure that the other signal going into the op-amp is also 5 volts. Our voltage regulator is supposed to give us 12 volts at the output, so I need to design the voltage divider in order to give us 5 volts starting from 12. Our load resistor is a pretty small resistor, 24 ohms. So whatever I choose for my voltage divider here, I mainly need to make sure that these values are large relative to my load. Let's choose R sub 2 at 5 kiloohms. From the equation, we can then determine that R1 needs to be 7 kiloohms. Let's find the current drawn by our sampling network. In other words, I'm interested in the current through these resistors. I know that the total resistance along this line is R1 plus R2, or 12 kiloohms. With 12 volts on that rail, I know that the current is going to be 1 milliamp. Our maximum load current is half an amp, so our sampling network only draws 0.5% of the load current. That's pretty small. I'm not even going to bother to calculate the power requirements of R1 and R2 because they're going to be on the order of milliwatts. Of course, our transistor needs to be able to handle the maximum load current, so it needs to have a power rating slightly higher than our load current because we have the base current as well. Let's now calculate the power rating of our transistor. Well, our maximum emitter current is going to be our maximum load current plus the current used by the sampling network. Our maximum load current is going to be a half an amp plus 1 milliamp for the sampling network. We're told that the maximum output current of the op amp is 3 milliamps. That's going to be our base current. Our base current's almost negligible here. Now, how we determine the power rating of the transistor is to basically take V times I, but what voltage should we use? The maximum voltage at the input is 24 volts, and the voltage at the output is 12 volts. So if the regulator is working correctly, the maximum voltage from collector to emitter is going to be 12 volts. Our transistor needs to be able to dissipate about 6 watts under normal operation, or a little bit higher than that. But what happens if something goes wrong? For example, what were to happen if somebody hypothetically replaces the load resistor with a short circuit? In that case, we would have 0 volts at the output rather than 12. We would then have 24 volts across our transistor. Our transistor would then need to be able to dissipate about 12 watts or a little bit more than that in order to not burn up. By the way, we're assuming here that the transistor's emitter current is limited by the base current available to the transistor. Since the beta of a transistor can vary, we really ought to add overcurrent protection to this circuit instead. We'll do that in the next video. For now, we'll assume a maximum output current of a half an amp. So, when designing a voltage regulator, this is actually something to keep in mind. If something were to go wrong at the load, you don't want to start a fire. For safety reasons, then, I would recommend that when designing this particular voltage regulator, the transistor should have a power rating of 12 watts rather than 6 watts.